Not every champion of Sigmar's creed is blessed with superhuman strength and immortality.
Armand, Callis, and Hanniver Toll are agents of the Order of Azir, mortal veterans of the shadow war between order and anarchy.
This is fought daily in the streets, noble districts, and grand halls of the God King's mighty cities.
Hello, and welcome to our painting guide on the Saviours of Cinderfall, Callis and Toll. We'll be painting these two heroes to battle ready, then adding a few extra tips and tricks to make them stand out even more. Then we'll be finishing them off by painting their cobblestone bases.
So, who's going to paint who? I'm going to pick Armand Callis. Now, I just really like this miniature. I like the jeweled pistols, I like the heavy plate mail, and also, just from a painting point of view, I saw these kind of like dark, grungy brown tones that's on the armor. So I thought it'd be really cool to try and do these with as few painters as I can and still make it look really cool.
Cool. And I picked Toll. I mean, Witch Hunter aesthetic is really awesome. Firewood stakes in hand, massive sword on his back, and he's just mysterious and quite quirky looking with that hat kind of pulled down over his eyes as well. So, but we're gonna really enjoy painting these models.
Yeah, absolutely cannot wait to get cracking on with mine. The paints we'll be using for Armand Callis are on screen now. From looking at the box art, we can see that he has a very muted palette. So we've replicated that with the paints we've chosen. However, remember that these are just our suggestions. You can paint your models however you like. There is also a list of the additional equipment we've used, but feel free to use whatever brushes you feel most comfortable with. If you're new to painting or want to brush up on your skills, you can check out the Citadel Colour Painting Essentials videos to learn all about our paints and painting techniques. We've chosen to undercoat Callis using Chaos Black Spray to give us a nice dark undercoat to work from. Right. Let's get painting. We'll start with Callis's skin first, and for this, we'll be using Catachan flesh to pick out his face and hands. A good tip when painting skin is to remember to keep our paint thin, as this will help to reduce unwanted texturing and give a nice smooth finish. So we'll just mix in some water with our Catachan flesh base until it flows really nicely off the brush, and then start applying it all over the model. Try not to paint the same area repeatedly. Once we've covered it, move on to another area. Wait for it to dry completely and then come back for another layer. We're going to pick out all of the black details next with Corvus Black. These are his trousers, leather belt and straps, tunic and hair. We can afford to be a bit messy here as we'll be painting over most of the other details in the following steps. Okay, with that done, we're now going to pick out his studded leather surcoat with Baylor Brown. Baylor Brown is a beautiful colour that we don't get to use very often, so it's really cool to crack it open. Because Baylor Brown is a layer paint and we're using it as a base, we'll need a few coats of it to get good coverage. So just remember to let it dry completely before coming back to do another. We'll be focusing on the brown leather details next, and for this we're using Mournfang Brown. We're picking out his boots, scabbard and leather bag attached to his belt. Be careful going around our previously painted details now. However, if we do make a mistake, then just tidy back up with those colours. Now to do his chest piece, and for this we're using Carrick Stone. Carrick Stone acts as a really nice contrast colour here to the rest of the model, so it will help to make the model pop out a bit. We're picking out the parchment that we can find on the model next, and we'll be using Rakarth Flesh to do so. We're switching to a small layer brush to do this as it's quite a small detail and there's loads of other painted areas around it. Having a small layer brush here will help us with control and hopefully reduce any errors. We're using Rhinox Hide to pick out the wooden elements of the pistols. From the box art, we can see that they are really dark brown, so Rhinox Hide works perfectly for this. Remember to carefully go around any areas that connect with the skin in order to reduce having to tidy up. We're moving on to our metallic details next, and we're going to focus on his armor, belt buckle, and studs first. We'll be using iron hand steel to pick out all of these details. We'll need a few layers of this to properly cover over the black undercoat, so just wait for your first to dry completely before doing the next. We've gone for iron hand steel as it is a brighter silver base coat that will allow us to do some of that awesome grungy brown tones that we can see on the box art later on. We're now going to use Iron Warriors to pick out the gunmetal on his pistols. This is a much darker silver base paint, so it will be perfect for his pistols. We've also switched to a small layer brush in order to make it easier for us to control the application. Our last metallic will be Skell Crusher Brass, and we're using it to pick out all of the armor trim that we can see. Skell Crusher Brass is rather bright, but we'll dull it down later on in the shading phase in order to tie it in nicely with the rest of the model. All right, with all the metallic paints done, the next thing that we need to do is to change our water pot, because we don't want to get any metallic flakes into the rest of our paints. Right, we've got a fresh pot of water, and now our first shade we're going to use will be non-oil, and we're applying it all over the skin, surcoat, black and brown leather, pistols, belt buckle, and gold trim. If we notice any pooling on the model, we'll just dry off our brush and then soak up the excess paint with our dry bristles. Okay, we're going to start on his plate mail next, and we're using non-oil again, however, this time we're mixing it with Larmium Medium to a 1-to-2 ratio. Larmium Medium will thin out our non-oil even more, so the pigment isn't as concentrated. This will allow us to slightly tint the armor, so we have some shading, but it's not too stark. We'll do a couple of layers of this, but you can do as many as you like. Remember that the more you do, the darker the armor will be. We're going to use Mortarian Grime and wash that all over the plate mail. Once the first layer is done, we'll do a second, more focused layer into any areas where there will be some natural shadow. So towards the bottom of the greaves and the underside of the knee armor, van braces, and shoulder plates. With that done, we're now going to wash Mortarian Grime over the parchment, chest detail, and studded leather surcoat. Now, we're going to use Rattling Grime Contrast, a much darker grimy brown, and mix it to a 1-to-2 ratio with Larmium Medium, and apply that into any areas of the armor where we want it to be really dark. This would typically be in the deeper shadow areas. We don't need to do much of this, just enough to fill out our previous Mortarian Grime step, but leaving some of it showing so that we get a nice natural gradient. Once that's done, we're going to use Rattling Grime straight from the pot to do a recess shade around all of the plate mail. Armand Callis is now battle ready, his armor suitably stained with the muck and grime from the underbelly of Cinderfall. You can stop here if you like, but we're just going to take Callis to the next level with a few extra steps to really make him stand out on the battlefield. For our first highlight, we're going to use Stormhurst Silver to edge highlight all of the metallic details. When highlighting armor, try to keep your lines as thin as you can, as this will help to sell the idea that the area is hard and a sharp surface. There are a few tricks that can help us with doing this. Don't put too much pressure through the brush when applying the paint. The more pressure we put into the brush will lead to more paint being put onto the surface. Lighter pressure allows us to control the application. We will also try to edge highlight towards ourselves where we can, as this will help loads with brush control, as it is far easier to see what we're doing brushing downwards than edging up and away from ourselves. Finally, try to find a pivot point for your brush hand with your spare fingers. This helps to keep your painting hand stable when applying the paint. As you can see here, I've got the pinky of my hand connected to my other hand, which holds the painting handle. This will help me stay stable and less likely to wobble about. Once all of our metallics are edged, we're then going to do a few little scratches here and there on the plate mail to make it look like Callis has been in a few fights as well. With the armor highlighted, we're now going to pick out his skin. For this, we'll be using Blood Reaver Flesh and just edging and layering over any raised areas. We're going to thin out our paint a little more than normal, as we don't want our Blood Reaver Flesh to be too opaque, as this will create a hard line between the base and the highlight, and that doesn't look very natural on skin. Before applying it to the model, just test out the mix on your palette, as we don't want it to be too thin and runny, because then it will just flow into the recesses. Once we're happy with the mix, we'll pick out the facial features and the raised areas of his hands. For our last highlight, we'll use Deathclaw Brown to pick out all of the brown leather and wood. For the leather, we'll do a stippled scratchy highlight over the raised areas of the leather. This will help to sell the idea that the leather has been worn and used. To do this, we'll use just the tip of our brush to do loads of little scratches along the raised details. As you can see, we're not doing a consistent line, but just breaking it up along the raised surface to give that rough feel. This is a really nice and easy way of adding some natural looking texturing to the leather. Once that's done, we'll just do a traditional edge highlight on the wooded parts of the pistols, picking out the edges and raised areas of the wood. All that's left to do is his base, and we're just going to quickly show you how to do that as well. To start off with, we're going to do a dry brush highlight of Mechanica Standard Grey all over the base. As you can see, we're doing circular motions to make sure that we hit all the edges. The Chaos Black undercoat will stay in the recesses and give us some nice natural depth. Once that first dry brush is complete, we'll do a second lighter one of Dawnstone. We're aiming to just pick out the most raised areas and corners of the base now, leaving the previous step around the majority of the cobblestones. The bases have a slight green tint to them. We'll use croak green and thin it to a 1-to-1 ratio with Larmium medium and then apply it all over the base. Nice and easy, and it has such an awesome payoff as well. For our final added detail, we can see that our base for Callis, as well as some of the others in the warband, have a gutter in it with some water details. So we're going to use Ardcoat and layer it over the gutter detail here to make it shiny and look like water. Easy peasy, lemon squeezy. And there we go, with that last detail on the base done, Armand Callis is complete. I've had so much fun with this model. The sculpt is absolutely fantastic and has been such a pleasure to paint. I can't wait to see what Emma does with Hanniver Toll. She's going to have a blast.
The paints and equipment for Hanniver Toll are on the screen now. These brown and dark metal tones will look great on our mysterious character. Both our heroes have very distinctive colours and styles, so you can stick with these colours or use some of the same ones as Callis if you want them to match a little bit more. Unlike Callis, we'll be using Mechanica Standard Grey as our undercoat, as it's a great neutral tone for the darker and lighter colours we'll be using. But if you wish, you could use the same undercoat as Callis and it will all be fine. We'll start Toll off with painting his cloak, trousers, hat and the pistol frame with Rhinox hide, using a small base brush. This will start off the grungy brown tone that our hero has. We'll need a couple of thin coats to get a solid but smooth brown colour. Even if this is our first colour, we want to be neat as we can, just so the few next colours have a neater finish. Next we'll be painting the dark red coat and hat band, and for this we'll be using Wordbearer's Red. As this detail is smaller, we'll use a medium layer brush for these. Just be mindful of the brown areas we just painted and the inside of the cloak and coat, as we want to keep them as clean as possible. So just take your time and get every section painted up layer by layer. So let's move on to even more brown colours. For the belts around Toll, we'll be applying Mournfang Brown. Even if this is another brown colour, this one has a much lighter and warmer shade, so it will stand out from the other tones once it's all shaded. This can make some of the details have a slightly different texture or feel straight away with ease. Now we have our brown tones down, let's keep going with more colours. Now we'll use Abaddon Black for the boots, gloves and gun holster. We can also use this for the straps that hold those two firewood stakes to his coat and the sculpted base, ready for painting later on. Even with a medium layer brush, we'll still get into those trickier to reach places, getting all of those coats applied in no time at all. If you do get any of this colour on the other details we already painted, just wait for it to dry and use the previous colours to tidy back over. Next we'll paint the firewood stakes on Toll's belt and attach to his flintlock pistol with Zandri Dust. Seeing that there are only three of these details on the model, this detail shouldn't take too long at all, but try and be careful and take your time when painting. We've got a lot of Toll already painted, so let's keep going and tackling some of the lighter colours next. For the inside of the cloak and coat, Toll's face and hair, and the inside of the lantern, we'll be using Grey Sear to get all those details lighter. As these details are all different shapes and sizes, we'll be using a small base brush and a medium layer brush, depending on what details we're painting. As we started with a neutral base coat, this will make life a little bit easier when we're applying multiple coats. So 2 to 3 thin layers should give us a solid colour that we're after. Once you're happy with all of your coverage, we'll apply some metallics to our Saviour of Cinderfall. For our first metallic, we'll be using Iron Warriors. We'll use this for the pistol, lantern, pauldrons, buckles, skull, buttons, keys and the sword grip and scabbard opening. Just like with all our base coats, we want to make sure that we get a couple of thinned coats to get a solid finish. But be careful, as if we smudge this paint onto our other colours, it may leave sparkly flakes if you try to wipe it off. So leave it to dry and tidy up afterwards. Now we're happy with our dark silver, let's add a brassy gold. For the sword hilt, pommel and scabbard end, we'll apply Skullcrusher brass, as it's bright and light for our azurite blade. We'll use a small layer brush, as this detail can be quite small compared to everything around it. So take your time with those multiple coats. Now we have those metals on the scabbard, we can quickly add a few coats of Abaddon Black for the leather. Doing this now means we can use it to tidy up any stray colours more efficiently. Now we're finished with our metallics, we'll quickly change our paint water, so we don't get any metallic flakes into the rest of our paints. Right, now our base coats are down, we'll start adding some shading. We'll thin down one part Rattling Grime with two parts Lamia Medium to create a grungy shade for pretty much all our colours. Just keep the paint flowing, but keep an eye on any excess pooling and soak that away with a clean brush. The only areas we want to avoid are the grey seared details, apart from Toll's hair. But don't worry if you get any on the face or the inner cloak and coat. We can always tidy up, ready for our next shade. Now to shade the grey sear cloak and coat with Soulblight Grey. We want to try and avoid pooling with this shade, as we don't want a foggy finish on any of the other details. We just want to make those shadowy areas a little bit darker and add some texture to the cloth. With that shade dry, we can now move on to Toll's pale and rugged face. For Toll's shadowed face, we'll use one part Gilliman Flesh thinned down with one part Contrast Medium. This will just make the contrast a little bit lighter, so we can apply a few coats to add some shadows in certain areas, and keep some lighter too. Just wait for each layer to dry before adding the next, and we'll be done in no time at all. Then for the lantern, we'll use Imperial Fist over the grey sear areas in two ways. We'll start with one part Imperial Fist and one part Contrast Medium, to cover all over the glass of the lantern, making sure that we don't apply it too heavily, but it sits nicely onto the recesses and tints like the glowing area. Then we'll use it straight out of the pot towards the outside of the glass and on the metal, as this is where the light will be glowing, hence more yellow in colour. The brighter towards the centre, the whiter the colour it is. This is a nice, easy glowing effect for our hero, to use in the dark and dank alleyways of the cities of Sigmar. Now Hanniver Toll is battle ready, his flintlock pistol out and lantern held high to hunt the enemies of Sigmar. You can stop here if you're happy with your model and start playing with your Saviours of Cinderfall. Or keep watching for a few extra steps for some more sharp looking details. To highlight the metallics, we'll be using Stormhose Silver and picking out the raised areas and points. We'll make sure that we have a point to our brush, so we get some sharp and clean highlights. We can do this by rolling the brush on the palette. And by doing this, this can also help us control the amount of paint that we apply too. Now we have picked out all those metals, let's highlight some more. For the black leathers, we'll be highlighting using Dawnstone. Just like with our first highlight, we want to use very small and thin lines on any raised areas, folds and edges. This will just give our black leather details a little bit more texture and light. And for the Rhinox hide, Wordbearer's Red and Mournfang Brown details, we'll use Baneblade Brown to highlight all of them. This colour works for all these red and brown tones nicely, without being too stark, and means that we don't have to use too many colours. We just need to pick out the most visible areas and details, and you'll have so many colours finished in no time at all. And now we can complete his base, just in exactly the same way as Adam did with Callis. That's why we base coated in Abaddon Black earlier, so we can crack on and get it painted. Toll was a great model to paint. His stern and mysterious style had so many details that was a joy to paint. Now our mighty heroes are ready to protect the civilians of the cities of Sigmar, hunting down vampires in the shadowy backstreets and banishing the servants of chaos and destruction alike. They may not be blessed with superhuman strength or immortality, but they are truly the finest of the Order of Azir.
For more tutorials, tips and tricks, you can always go check out our Warhammer YouTube channel, or you can go to your local store where our amazing staff will be more than happy to help.
Well, we had a blast painting these two heroes and we hope you had a great time watching. See you later.
Bye.